Alright, so this is Drome Racers All Challenges New Game Plus. This means we have to beat every single challenge and we can do it on an already completed save file. Let's get into it. Alright, so first up we have Battery. This is our off-road and the main obstacle we have to be aware of here is a tornado. So that's gonna be fun. Right then, at the beginning of the race, what we call early second gear, where if you time the start of the race just right, you get immediately into second gear. Now here I got hit by one of many items, and this one actually completely slowed me down. So the item I've been hit by there is a homing item, which means if the opponent has this item in it, and the opponent is able to see you, then it will home onto you, and definitely hit. That one has quite the chance of actually completely removing your ability to accelerate. So getting hit by that is very bad unless you're at a high speed. Right, so here on the second lap we will start to see the main obstacle of the course being this tornado. And while some logic would state that you probably have to drive around the tornado to not get hit by it, the most efficient way actually is to drive straight through the tornado. Then the tornado kind of pulls you in and that pull will then launch you out. So if you're in a position where the tornado is badly placed, and trust me, there will be times where the tornado is badly placed, it's totally worth it to just ride straight through the tornado. You might hear a cow or two, but don't worry about it, the cows will be fine. So this is a deck-based racing game, and it's kind of like Mario Kart in some aspects. Drive around the track for 3 laps, and then you win if you complete the 3 laps faster than the opponent. Also, there are items that you can pick up, and then you can use those. But you have to be careful because some items can backfire if you don't use them properly. Like the item I have right now is the axe, and the pro tip is just to never ever use the axe ever. It's kind of like Green Shell from Mario Kart, in that you like use it and then probably get hit by it yourself. Except it's way more hectic than a green shell. So if you get a max, just don't use items that way. It's not a big deal. The only really item to speed us up is like one of the 6 items in the first place. And it's very rare and very RNG dependent. Also, it's not really practical to use said item in most of the races. So now we're racing again, and you might think, well, hold on, this is the same race. Aren't you only supposed to do the races once? Well, this is actually the B route. So what we have for each of the challenges, actually every single one of the levels have an A route and a B route, and they're slightly different. The A route tends to be more straightforward with less stuff, with less obstacles, and it's generally the first version of the level you get introduced. And then the B route has more obstacles and a slight change in the route. Like right here, this part is unique to the B route. Those bumps and like that whole section is unique to the B route of Battery. So there are 6 challenges, each with 4 races. So we have the A route and the B route, but what are the 2 others? Well, the other 2 are the reverse routes. So you have A reverse and B reverse. And that should be self-explanatory. The A reverse is basically the A route, but driven the other way around the track. And the B reverse is basically the B group, but with the other way around the track. Interestingly though, some aspects like items and boost panels don't get moved when you change from the reverse route to the non-reverse, and some of them do get moved. I'm not quite sure how they decided to move some of the things, but not all of them. I don't know why or how. I just know exactly what things are moved, and that knowledge comes from practice, because it's consistent. So the item I picked up there, that's a new item. You can see that in the bottom left corner. That's a homing missile. So the homing missile is kind of like a wet shell for my way cat. Except I actually have to, just like with the other homing item, I have to be in a position where I'm behind my opponent and actually physically able to see my opponent in front of me before it will home. I can't use it without, but then it will just fly in a straight line and walk home into anything, making it pretty useless. So the main thing we're interested in when driving around the place, to be fast, we of course want to hit B panels. Those are the small green things in the ground, one right there, where you drive on top of it and you get a speed boost. There's another one here. And those are the most important thing. The more we hit of those, the more speed boost we get. And speed boost is of course a higher top speed, an instant acceleration up to that. But then after some time we will then go back to normal top speed. So here you can see the homing, and you can see the missile. As soon as it locked down, it just homed into the enemy. Right. So speed panels are very important. That right there was a mine. There's another mine. So if you place those mines down, they are kind of like banana peels from Mario Kart, where anyone who drives over the mine will just get hit and flung up in the air. Alright, so coming up to battery A reverse. You can also see I'm doing the menu very fast. And that's a technique we call semi-blind menu, where you just do the inputs. And then, hopefully if you time it right, you will do it at the right time and will register all the inputs, even though the menu has quite fully loaded. It's very inconsistent, so sometimes it might just get you to the wrong level, which is bad. Anyway, the second thing we're interested, apart from the speed boost, is the item bubbles. Not so much the wet one. The wet ones are the ones that actually give you an item, but they are also the green ones. So I talked about this being a Lego-based technique. That's true. It's, well, some would consider it kind of like Lego Racers 3, even though it doesn't have that name. It had that name during production though. It was like the development code name, Lego Racers 3. So the cars are made of Lego, and are actually based around real Lego cars. And that means if you get damaged or get hit by some, drive into a wall or whatever, your car gets slightly damaged, and the more damage you get, the more parts it will actually lose. And if you don't have a car with like a full health stack, then that's bad. It gets harder to steer, the acceleration gets slower, and the top speed falls down a lot. So basically, you want your car to be fully healed at all times, and those green item bubbles actually heal you. So it's very important to pick up a green item bubble whenever. So that's like the fundamentals. Try to hit as many speed boosts as possible, as long as they're not too much out of the way. Try to hit the green bubbles to recover yourself. And then secondly, after that, maybe try to get a... what's it called? A item. Yeah. Alright, so moving on to Array. This is the first street level of the one. And the big gimmick here is a huge spiral. So in the A route and B route, the spiral goes upwards. And then in the reverse route, because you drive the other way, it goes... Sorry, in the reverse, it goes downwards in the normal. Let me fix that. So as you can see, it goes downwards now, and that's the normal route. And then reverse, you will have to go upwards. But the thing about the spiral is, you really don't turn very well in this game. As you can see, I make very small adjustments and just completely got sliding there. Almost like I was doing some sick drift. Trust me, the controls are just a bit slippery. So if you have, when you have to go down a spiral, it's especially difficult. So that's like this big obstacle, is to get down the spiral, hopefully without hitting anything. But yeah, other than that, that's not really anything to say. Area is actually one of those levels where getting the extreme speed boost item actually is useful. So what that does, let me explain that. There's one of the items you can get. I don't quite know the odds. I have looked into the game code, but there's a chance that you can get this speed boost item, which basically gets you to hover and increases your max speed by a lot. So right now I'm going close to 290 kilometers an hour, and it just puts it up to like 320, somewhere around there. But then it highly decreases the handling stat. So right there, I accidentally picked a track I'd already beaten. So that loses 20 seconds. That's what I talked about with the fast menuing. So I did it wrong. I lose about 20 seconds because you have to then have the race load, exit out, and then go back and select challenges. But yeah, it decreases your handling a lot. So you might just smash into a wall, and then it's useless to have the extra top speed. So yeah, it handles terribly. But if you have like a long straight road, then it's really, really good because it's more speed, which is amazing. So I'm probably gonna, if I get the item, I'm gonna use it on Array. And there it actually is. So that's the item signaling the speed boost. And I'll be using it coming up on a straight edge. So that's another thing. You could get really, really lucky with the items you're getting and have a speed boost for every single lap. That takes some incredible luck. Or you could just get access and access and access worth absolutely nothing. so that item I just got hit by, thing that blinded me, is an item you can only get when you're in last. So you'll never see me getting it, but you might see the opponent hitting me with it a couple of times. So that's basically a thing that blinds you and slows you down a little when it hits you. And basically what it does is the user sends it off and hits everyone in front of the user. So in a six player way, player 4 uses it, players 3, 2 and 1 will all get hit by it. That's another one. So yeah, going back to the items, that's really the big RNG part of this one. You could just have ways where you get hit by item over item over item. It's a bit annoying, especially because you actually have to win every single race. And if the computer gets lucky enough with the choice of items, then you might just get screwed for days. Alright, so interluding, we are in Wokworms. I did another menuing mistake. This one is not so bad because I hadn't beaten this level yet. And that brings me to talking about some of the rules we have in the community. So for all challenges, New Game Plus, it's specified that it's on a already completed save file. On an already completed save file, you have all these challenges unlocked. All 24 ways is unlocked from the get-go. So we decided in the community, since you don't get an advantage from beating one ways before another, you could do the ways in any order, as long as you do all 24 of them. So what that means in practice is, if I do a menuing mistake and I end up selecting a level I have not beat yet, then I'm allowed to beat it and carry on with the run. This just means that I have to put in a mental note for myself, of course, to say, okay, I've already beat Rocky Worms A, so there's no reason to choose it again whenever I would have got to Rocky Worms A in the wild. So I will talk about more about Rocky Worms when we actually get to it in the wild. Not really much to talk about there. Okay, then we can talk about some of the things that might be relevant about the items. So we have the mine, and the computer will reallocate a mine. It's mostly stuff you get in the first position, and if we drive somewhat well, the computer should never be in first. So the mine, you just place like right on a speed boost or something, because the computer will go over it, and it's fine. If we get a mine, we just want to use it in order to get another item and try our luck getting something better. Then we have this item. I don't think I've explained that yet. This is the electrical shield. It does not shield you from getting hit by items. However, if you're close to the opponent and use it, you can bounce off the opponent, just almost like hitting them with an item, shielding yourself from getting hit by them. That's really cool. It also has this quirk where if you use it and drive into an item bubble or a health bubble, you won't actually collect it. You'll still be able to hit speed boost, but you won't be able to collect bubbles while you have the shield activated. So that's a funny perk. Then we have the homing stun lock, which I talked about, where you have to basically, if you get hit by it, you hope that you're already at high speed or that it doesn't stun lock your engine, because then you can't accelerate. So when it hits you, it randomly lowers one of your stats, and if it's the acceleration and you're at low speed, then that's just bad. It can lower top speed, but not as much. It can lower handling. It can lower grip. But generally speaking, we just worry about if it lowers our acceleration. So the way you would normally handle getting hit by that is either, like, if you're at high speed, you would just keep going. Just accept that it didn't hit you on the top speed and just go forward. If you're not at maximum speed, one of the strats is actually to just slam into a wall. Because it's homing on you and flying above your head, it will actually try to rubber band the sensor of your car. So if you just slam into a wall, it will try to slingshot further into the wall to then have something to slingshot back. And if it gets stuck in the wall, then it would just break instantly. So here I try to use the speed boost, and as you can see, I'm easily hitting 305 kilometers an hour. And there, with much more success, I actually landed straight on all four wheels. So that helps a lot. Because if you're in the speed boost and you land on some kind of imbalance, then you will just basically get down to 0 kilometers an hour and have to accelerate up again, which sucks a lot. Yeah, so as I said, you get a lot more obstacles in the B route. And in airway, as we're finishing up now, the obstacles for the B route is almost some. I feel like it looks like someone working on the road. See, it's coming up fairly soon. Then I can explain. But yeah, it would be like these barriers coming up in this tunnel. The one you see here. Those aren't there in the A route. So that's like the big thing. Yeah, there's not really much to say. The next thing, I guess, is to talk about the donation incentive. Which is not really going to be an incentive, but more of a bid war. So as you can see here at the start of the race, when it looks at my car, and you can also see on the map to the left that I'm actually right now driving a blue car. But I don't have to drive a blue car, so the bid war is basically choose what color car we're driving throughout the one. And it's gonna be a choice between a red car, an orange car, a blue car, a green car, and a black car. Red, orange, blue, green, black, and yellow. Yellow is the final option, so there's six to choose from. Alright, so now we're at Monument Park. The fun thing about this is right now we're driving on a ship. Boom. Now we're off the ship. And then another exciting thing would be to talk about B route you actually get. Like the only 180 turn in like the entire game is on Monument Park B route. So that's a bit interesting to talk about. Alright, back to the items. Then we have the homing missile. And the homing missile, if you get hit by those, we actually have a strat for recovering. It's a bit precise and doesn't always work even though you're doing the inputs right. But the idea is when you get hit by the homing missile, you'll get hit up into the air and then you will be spinning. And actually the amount you will spin depends on weird enough if you're holding down the speedometer or the gas pedal. So the strat is actually to just release gas and then press gas as soon as you land again. Because if you are holding down gas when you land from that rotation, it's just a 50-50 to completely stop in the track. However, sometimes it might be the timing being off and might just be the trick being inconsistent. But sometimes you will not land facing forward, either land facing into the wall or facing the opposite direction. So it's not as optimal to just be firing super fast again. Right, then we can talk about catch-up, because in the early challenges, as you can see here, I'm currently on the third difficulty of challenge, because I'm doing it in order of difficulty. And I'm lapping these guys easily. Monument Park is definitely the easiest place to lap, in my opinion. But it definitely gets harder and harder to lap, because the AI and the rubber banding, or catch-up as this game calls it, it gets better as time goes on. So by the time we get to Nokong, which is the final challenge, it will be extremely tough. And pretty much when we get to like Walkworms and Nokong Raceway, you actually have to be somewhat skilled in order to pull off the win. Both skilled and lucky. Because if you're lucky, the computer just won't get any good items to slow you down, and you'll be able to drive from them. But if you're unlucky, the computer will actually get item upon item upon item, and just always stay really close to your tail, so they can hit you with even more homing items. Now we can talk about something you probably already heard during the rounds, which is the warning sound. So you get a warning whenever the enemy has a homing item that is currently homing at you. Not necessarily that the enemy has released the item yet, but just that they are homing. So you'll get the warning at least before getting hit by the homing stun duck or the homing missile. However, you do not get a warning if you are about to get hit by an axe. Then you just get hit. That sucks. That's not fun. Because you know when the missile's coming, you know when axe, but you don't know when the axe is coming. I think that goes back to the Mario Kart logic. In Mario Kart, you get a warning when you're about to get hit by a windshield, but ain't nobody gotta warn you about a windshield. That's the 180, if you didn't see it. The other time we played the B-Roof. And as far as I'm aware, that's the only 180 you're doing in the entire race. Now, some would argue that the spiral that we have to do in airway is technically a 180. But no, it's not. It's spiral, so it's way more than a 180. Also, that's actually a 180, roughly on the same level where the spiral is going downwards or upwards. Yeah, there's not really much to add. At this point, it would probably be a lot of donations getting wet. Introducing the couch, which will probably be in the beginning of the one, but still they need introducing. The big shoutouts goes to the guy who actually can't be with us at ESA. He goes by Jorslav, and he's an amazing one of this game. And as of recording this, he's the current world record holder of this category. Truly amazing guy. Really, really dedicated to his sequence. So yeah, shout out to Joshua. Rocky Canyon Speedway. So we can talk about this. This is a new track we made it to. And the big caveat we have to watch out for here are those falling rocks. Which, as far as I know, they are actually random. I haven't tested this intensely, but I think the falling marks actually went up in their location. And how many rocks fall. So at the beginning of the lap, that's a place where you can sometimes encounter fallen rocks. That's not fun. We might get to see them here in the B-Room. This might be one of those special obstacles. So another thing we do is, if we actually manage to get that early second gear, you have enough speed to drive in front of the opponent and get the speed panel. If you don't get the start boost, the AI probably won't either, so then have to almost fight to get to the speed boost, and that can be awfully very fast. So I only ever go forward if I actually get the second gear. So the way to get that, there's of course some timing to it. So to get early second gear, what you need to do is when the race starts, let go of gas. Don't touch the gas at all until they actually say go. And then it's like right when they say go. If you're too early, just a little bit, then you'll have to accelerate from first gear. If you're too late, you'll get second gear but not get the speed boost. And if you're just right, you get early second gear and get the speed boost. Which is of course the one we want the most. It's actually more desirable to be a little early than a little late in most cases, because we would rather get the acceleration than we would get that we would want second gear off the start. Alright, now for Rocky Canyon Speedway A reverse. Not a lot to be said about this either. So this game came out in 2002 and was built, designed and said to be very futuristic. So this is apparently Lego's of 2002's idea of what the future looks like. Funny thing is that it's supposed to be set in 2015, which is 4 years ago. This is what the world looked like 4 years ago, apparently. With all of those high-tech future things. Looks cool, don't get me wrong. I wanted to have lived in that 2015, that's for sure. And if that's what 2015 looked like, I really want to see today if those standards were kept. That was interesting, and that's one of those examples of the game's physics being a bit wonky. Right there, I hit a wall and just got spun. Like, out of nowhere.
Ten.
That just happened. Sometimes, like that, I could get started pretty quickly. It wasn't a big deal. A lot of times it just kills all your momentum. So that's interesting. Right there, I got hit by the stun lock. I didn't care at all. Also, while we were on stun lock, you weren't able to see the item. But you can actually hear from the audio what item I would get. So I knew, even though I couldn't see, that I had gotten the speed boost. Rocky Canyon Speedway isn't the greatest place to get a speed boost, but up probably end up using it anyways. Because why not? Gotta find out why it's not a good thing to have a speed boost. Waiting just to get out where there's no tight corners before activating this. Side of things. That's cool. Yeah, sometimes you'd rather have the handling than a potential speed boost. And it's really something you've got to judge on a case-by-case basis. Alright. So that was Wagyu Canyon Speedway, and now we go to Wagyu Worms. Wagyu Worms. So we've already been to Wagyu Worms, so I actually start on the B route now. So here we go. The big thing about Wagyu Worms is we're finding a lot of tunnels and a lot of tight tunnels as well. Here is probably the tightest tunnel we have. It's really tight and sometimes it spits fire at your car, which actually damages it. And there's just nothing you can do about it, you just gotta fly through the fire and take the damage. That's a bit annoying. Then we have like this open space and then right after the finish line it's back into a tunnel. Speedrun.com and look for Drome Racers, which is the name of this game. And then if you look under resources, then we also have a Discord where we talk about strats and post TVs and stuff like that. So it's definitely the place to go if you want to get into wanting this game. Speedrun.com and our Discord. like to recommend watching a guy called Random Jellyfish. He wants Lego races. As I said, this is technically Lego Races 3, or it was at development time. And he wants the first two games. Not currently active, but he had one at some point. He's a really cool dude, you should check him out. He also wants other games. He's just generally cool. So yeah, shout out to Rabbit Jellyfish. If you just wanna like more normal racing games, I could definitely recommend checking out Viber, aka the GBP 13. Right, so there I accidentally chose the wrong challenge again. We actually have Walkworms be reversed. Everyone should check out PBJ. That's lowercase with underscores between the letters P_P_J. PBJ is the most amazing person ever. So you should all go check him out. Done with Walkworms, which means we only have one challenge left for waste, and that will be no count waste weight. So maybe getting back to this one. This one ended up being a 56 minutes 36 seconds. 56, 36, 24. So 24 hundredths of a second. Which is decent. World record is 51 minutes. So that's like 5 minutes better. As I said, it's won by George Love. But this time was actually really good and not a lot of mistakes happened. So estimate for the marathon is gonna be 1 hour and 10 minutes because there's a lot of things that can go wrong that just didn't here. One of the main things being the menuing. You can mess up the menuing a lot. And it's 20 seconds every time you mess up. Then you can have terrible luck with the items and the opponent just rubber banding you like crazy and getting good luck with items while you get the worst of items. Then you can just hit random walls and random bumps in the road. Which I'm not quite sure why they're there, but there can be random bumps in the world where they will just stop you, throw you in the air, and waste a lot of time. Yeah, that's not so fun when that happens, but it can happen. That's why the estimate is so high at an hour and 10. So yeah, that's Nokang Raceway A route. So now we're moving on to B route. And there's really not much of obstacles to the B route. It's more really of a round change and some sharp turns. Racetrack that looks the most like a normal racetrack. Or really more like a road that's just been marked off so we could have a race on it, but still. First challenge, and it ends as soon as you finish lap 3 of no count B reverse, or whatever happens to be your final race, which for most people tends to be no count B reverse, because you're doing some sort of order. Also, there was my final menu mistake. Makes a total of 3 mistakes where I had to quit out, and a 4th mistake where I just chose a level I hadn't beaten yet. So it was fine. So 4 mistakes, where three of them actually cost me the 20 seconds. That ends up being a minute time loss just for menuing. Would have made this a 55-36, which would almost be a PB of mine. But yeah, so it was a really good one with not a lot of driving mistakes compared to this game's physics, at least. And I think it's really good because it showed off a lot of the things that can happen and showed off a lot of the tricks as well. As for this being in a marathon, Drome Races has been in a marathon once before. It was at UKSG. United Kingdom-based marathon, where Viper ran. I think it was Beginner Cups. Now we're at the final race. This is No Count Raceway B reverse. And the AI is really doing everything it can to hit me. So I'll get a hit for a little bit and boom, get hit again. Just everything you can to stay on my tail. Remember, one of the rules is we actually have to win every single race, not just complete it, but we have to win. So in the case where you would lose to these guys, it's a solid 2 minutes time loss, depending on the track. The reason we have decided that you have to win is obviously if you were doing this new game, you would have to win each and every challenge to unlock the next one, and then of course win the final challenge in order to beat the challenges. Because in the new save file they don't all unlock at the same time. The A route is unlocked, and then when you win the race on A route, B route unlocks, and then when you win the race on B route, and that's time, by the way. Yeah, when you win on B route, A route unlocks, and so on. So yeah, that's time. When I cross the finish line there, and that's it.